I'd like to give an introduction about Keshu Scott. She's an internationally renowned diversity trainer and consultant, an associate professor of American Studies and Sociology at Grinnell College, and an award-winning writer. So if I can say, Zubeda, you can begin your conversation.
Can we begin? I'm actually going to start, and can you hear me? I'm very loud in general as a teacher, so please, I apologize in advance. I'm sitting here next to an amazing woman who is a journalist, an editor, a mentor for young women, a woman who has contributed to the field of journalism, and a lifetime award winner in this field. So I am honored. This is the first time that we've met. And being asked to tell our stories, what one of my goals is that we be able to exchange the things that have happened that have brought us to these places. Her memoir, in my mind, since I teach American autobiography, is the story of her intimate story in her field. And it is also, as well, a historical account of the background of this field and the way in which women live out their passion in their fields. I know nothing about it. So I want to say that straight out. I know nothing about it. So I'm in a learning situation. But having read your book, you opened three doors for me. One of those doors is the history of journalism in Pakistan. Your details were amazing. So I was the learner in that situation. The second door that you opened for me was the role of Don as a print media. I had no knowledge of that. Americans are typically ignorant of other people's writings and other people's print media. And I was also ignorant. And the third thing is that by reading your book, I learned about your specific contributions to Pakistani women's liberation. And that was particularly important to me. So I'm going to open with that. I have a series of quotes that I've extracted from your book that I want to ask you about. And I think they will show a parallel in unity in what we have done in our lives. You bet. They can't hear you. They're not able to hear you. Your mic is not working.
Is it working now?
Okay.
That because there's so many similarities, so we wanted to exchange views on that rather than one questioning the other. We'll just speak like we are talking to each other in a kind of a conversation, a dialogue. So you want to ask the first thing, or should I?
Why don't you?
Well, first of all, I think, thank you, Keshu, for all the nice things you've said. And I also, I was very excited to meet you, especially when I read your two books, The Habit of Surviving and Tight Spaces. So I think the books themselves, they made me really very keen to meet you. And of course, you are an excellent writer too, because how you've written it, the new words you've coined, like the habit of surviving itself is something very important. Although I never used it, but when I thought of it, I said, I think we are all doing it all the time. And of course, there was the girl's energy, that's one you've said. And then there's this autofictography, that's another term which I learned. So I think I would like to ask Keshu is that why don't you tell us something about this habit of surviving, which I think all of us will in some way identify, and then I'll tell you, how I survived.
Absolutely. The motivation for me in this notion of my theorizing notion of the habit of surviving is something I actually learned from an American singer who in the 1940s, she was an African American singer, and she found herself in New York City singing in front of an audience of German soldiers who were prisoners, actually. And if you know the history of the United States, you know the history of people like me, African American, lived under racial segregation. So imagine this very important singer being asked to go to the back door to come in to sing in front of German soldiers who, in fact, were the, at that point, the enemy of the United States during World War II. So they ask her about the hypocrisy and the contradiction of that situation. And they ask her how she survived it. And she said, "I have the habit of surviving." And that really struck me because I realized that my own mother exhibited some of those same qualities. Those qualities of surviving under the most insane situations, not only American racism at the highest point and the struggles to change that, but those struggles in her family, in her marriage. My father was an alcoholic. He worked in a factory under horrendous circumstances. They divorced, so my mother then was a divorced and marked woman. And how then did she, with a 10th grade education, raise three amazing children, me being the oldest and me being, I think, the smartest? So in my way, that idea of habits of surviving are traits that women develop as they fight against multiple oppressions and that they transfer to their daughters and their sons. So what that was the organizing principle.
What are the traits?
Well, some of the traits. Can we do this by show of hands? How about that? Would you be willing to participate? All right, let me tell you one of the habits. Ready? Okay. All right, one of the habits is that you have the ability to stay focused on your children and simultaneously work. Raise your hand. Oh, so some of you have, by the way, I don't see any men raise your hand. Men? All right, thank you. Another habit is the habit of having clarity around when someone is oppressive to you, but realizing that you cannot speak out against that because you have to keep your job. So you stay cool, as we say in the United States. Raise your hand. I see that Pakistanis have some of those habits. How many people have ever been in an educational situation and asked to write something that doesn't really represent your experience or your culture, but in order to pass that class, you write what they ask in an educational situation? Right. These are all strategies, and there are millions that people who have not had privilege, people who have been oppressed, people who have been colonized, people that have lived under racial segregation, people that because of their gender have been excluded from participation, have had to develop those habits of survival. And I call them dances that they do.
Mm-hmm. Well, you see, in a way, even I use that, this same strategy when I joined Dawn. I wouldn't say I was the first woman in journalism because that is a kind of, some misunderstanding which has taken place. There were women before me, but I did join journalism at that stage where I could say I could influence policies and I could also then open doors for other women to come in. And there were later on, when more women came in, they learned a lot from me. I didn't realize I was mentoring them. But as for surviving, what I did feel in the beginning, that because I was the only one there, that I knew I couldn't fight so many. And Well, it was. I was lucky that the men were generally good, and I didn't have to undergo the kind of situation you did, Kesho, in your society, because it was a much wider struggle. But mine in the paper, what I did do was that if there was something, as you pointed out just now, that I didn't have to write. I mean, I didn't want to write about it, but since it was needed, I would do it. And the other thing is that I think this happens with most women, that at least at that stage when you are the first one and you are trying to retain your hold there, because it's very easy to be eased out if you are just one or two. You can't protest. Even if you protest, nobody will listen. But when there are more, then you can do more. And the other thing is that it did put a lot of pressure that you had to be a kind of a superwoman. And I think, Kesho, you also speak about the superwoman.
So I think this idea of a superwoman, I want to see a show of hands. I remember joining a university setting in the 80s. And I looked at that time, there were 17 women faculty of 149 at the college. And in that setting, we met for the first time as women. And the older women said to me, I don't have a family, I don't have a partner, because in order to be taken serious as a scholar, I had to give those things up. And I remember saying to myself, I'm not giving up marriage, I'm not giving up children, that those are the restraints that that generation had, but that I was not interested in that. So how many people, how many women have been in a situation where balancing their family and balancing their careers and balancing their connection to their community have been strained? Raise your hand. Absolutely. And yet, because what motivated me to write was to write about that story, because it's often invisible. We live it, but we don't talk about it. So for an example, those restraints sometimes are not just about the chauvinism. In fact, from your book, there was a quote I read. Can I read you this quote from her book? Is that okay? All right, I want to read you this quote. You talk about early in your book about ambition, and someone had raised the question to you about why you're not an editor, why you don't, you know, how come you don't become, you know, the boss, in other words. And you said that I didn't do so not because I was a victim of male chauvinism, which people presumed, but that administration would take you away from your writing, and you assumed that your writing was your power. And I think that in my way, this was very important to me. I'm a community activist. I work for the most disadvantaged people in my community. And being an academic was not first. It was the way I made a living. But my commitment to my community was much more important. That my knowledge was based on I walked over the back of someone else. And it was my job to return that knowledge back to people. So, and again, here we have a similarity, because your work in writing about education and health was absolutely crucial.
And another thing which I find common in what we write is our concern for the community. And of course, for Kesho, how I read it, that it's, of course, your community. And for me, it's not that specialized, it's generally the community in Pakistan. And the issues which I took up were, of course, education, because that, I think, is very, very basic. When we speak of women's empowerment, which I find from your book, is that I think education was still taken more seriously by your community, the women there, say your mother, and even other women of that generation. And unfortunately, education is not our strong point. And it's very definitely also a class issue, that Absolutely. The upper class will have the best of education. The poorer class, the disadvantaged classes, they don't have it. And that is what I wanted to once I started writing on social issues, I discovered this very soon, and that is why I wanted to write about it. And the same thing about women also, that because they are not educated, we should not even speak about empowerment, because a woman who does not even know what her rights are, well, how is she going to struggle for empowerment? She should know and also read about other women, and you derive so much from books. And how do you feel about it, Keshu? I think you agree with that.
I absolutely agree with that. My mother had a 10th grade education. My mother married at 16, had me at 16, and never returned to school until after her divorce. In fact, in the United States, there was no fault divorce until 1960. And what I remember my mother's thinking, this is what I mean, the habit of survival, and the brilliance of my mother living that life, was my mother said that nothing keeps you from reading. So guess what every Saturday my mother made us do? My brothers and I had to walk a mile to the library, spend 5 hours a day on Saturdays reading, and coming back later while she slept, because she then became the worker of our family. And we had to come back and tell her what it is that we learned. So reading and education was extremely important. No one restricts that if you take that as part of your education. And I think that reading is a political act. And I think it is something that we are in charge of.
And, also about your activism, which you said, of course, my activism, partly I was involved with the Women's Action Forum.
Yes.
But, I mean, I wasn't in the forefront that way, but I was reporting it. So that in itself was something important for it, because, as you said, you read about the state of the media in Pakistan and
yes.
how tightly controlled it was. So whatever we could get in, and at times ours was the only paper in the very early years which was reporting the activities of the Women's Action Forum. Or even now, a lot of it, because I know a lot of what I write doesn't reach the women, because those women who need it, because they cannot read. So that is why I feel very concerned about it. But how do you sort of get the message across to women, especially when, and I think that way it would be easier, because they can read. They can read your writing also. But do you employ other means also?
I think I do. And I think one is learning by example, right? I think it's really important. Are you an example of the ideas that you believe in? For an example, I think that you have to work inside of the system and you have to work outside of the system. And one of the ways that I worked in the system, which is a way that I share with you, I love this example in your book where you talked about you didn't use confrontational tactics because they would not work. Well, how many times do you think I experience, as the only woman of color, so many settings every time I moved up in academia? I had to experience those kinds of slights on the part of my colleagues. But what I did is, instead of reacting, I was able to turn that situation into an educational moment. And when I then controlled the classroom, one of the ways I did is I had my students leave the classroom and be involved in some sort of community service. So I take a unit of my teaching and I have them do some project in the community where they get to take their knowledge and present it to people who maybe aren't readers or constituencies that have been excluded. So that's one of the ways that I do it. By the way, I want to say that one of the things that I want you to share more is that there's one section in your book where you said, I had problems with often the stances that I took on women's issues. I was reminded that the feminist message had to be conveyed subtly. Can you say some more about that?
Well, actually, you see, that is the whole issue, that the feminist message is somehow, sometimes I feel it's not getting across to everyone, especially the people who need it most. And it's also, I think, our culture and our society, how they suppress the women, and the patriarchal approach which we have. So it's not this, that this is my right or this is what I should do. It becomes that I mean, this is right, this is wrong. So that is the whole issue which I felt that that was not right. And of course, even in other places like over here, that whatever I wrote, and if people, they took objection to it, so they would go and talk to the editor about it. Probably they didn't even consider me important enough
Absolutely.
To come and talk to me. So, but that way I was fortunate. I had a very enlightened, progressive minded editor, and he supported me because he, in a way, agreed to what the feminist, I would say he was a feminist himself, his wife was a feminist. So that way, that helped me a lot, at least in my newspaper work and in what I wrote. And it, well, I hope some changes have come about. So I would like to ask you, Kesho, that you also speak about changes. And that is, I think, what we all are trying to. I think anyone who's trying to bring about it, any difference, I think that was the word used in the last session. But I would rather use the word change. And that is taking place. How do you feel about it? Especially, I liked it when you write about your mother, about yourself, and about your daughters. So that's three generations.
All right, I'll answer that. Because my study was about women who were born in the 30s, raised in the 40s, and became parents in the 50s, I was interested in what their habits of survival were, given the background of American culture at the time. So remember, my mother's generation didn't have a chance for education. They didn't have a chance for social activism. I was born in the 50s, raised in the 60s, became a parent of four children in the 70s. So I was exposed to the social movements of the 60s and the 70s and the worldwide struggles against colonialism and US imperialism in particular. So I had a different outlook. My daughters were born in the 70s and 80s, raised in the 90s, and are now today 40, 38. My son is 26, and my youngest daughter is 16. So each of us were raised in a different cultural milieu, which gave them different ideas for activism. And each of them, I think, all of those generations, my mother's, mine, and my daughter's, have had a feminist outlook. But let me tell you what I think that feminism means, because I come from a society in which there is privilege. And my feminism is not the feminism of someone who has white privilege. It doesn't make them bad, it makes them privileged. So as an African American whose people were excluded from higher education, from professionalization, being in unity with people with privilege who didn't want to fight that struggle for me made it difficult. So I think that one of the ways in which there is change is that for those of us in countries that have had colonial past, for those of us who countries that have had racial segregation, for us to see the similarities in the ways in which we fight internally in our jobs and the way that we fight interpersonally. Because all of us know, by raising your hand, for an example, the impact of colonialism, the impact of racism, the impact of discrimination. Raise your hand if you know that's true. Only a few of you. It has an impact. If all your role models don't come from your culture, then you doubt yourself. If all of your role models come from only what one gender does, then you doubt yourself. Is that not true? Absolutely. If all your role models and all the books that you read and all the models come from someone else's story, you doubt yourself. I think today when I look forward in 2018, I see that there have been many changes and that what has happened is that this literary festival is a testimony in my mind of how your women in your culture and in mine have written so that younger women can absolutely see how things have changed. We have to go to question and answer.
Okay.
All right, who's going to be first to ask the question? Please do. Can you thank us? How about thanking us? All right.
I think even brief comments would be welcome, just to get their point of view.
That's good. We would like you to please feel free to share your point of view also.
Why do you think reading is a political?
I think that reading is political because, one, it puts you in a position of realizing, is what you reading your experience? And being able to know what your experience is to be able to influence then others. One of the things that's really interesting as an educator is that we make sure that we provide multiple views. Well, if schooling is someone else's curriculum, then education comes from your community life. So I think that when you begin to really educate through reading, you're bringing multiple points of views, and that is political. And that is not just the purview of those who control and have privilege, it is the purview of those people who also resist. And I think there is a tradition of resisting, and we need to read about it.
Well, I would also suggest that, right, you don't have to really chase a publisher. But, you know, if you write, because I've experienced it myself, we have a lot of thoughts and ideas floating in our mind. But when you have to write, you have to think, because thinking is very important. And very often we don't think enough. But when you have to write, you have to think. And I think many things will become clearer to you. Even if you write a diary and just keep it for yourself, even that is a very good idea.
Thank you. Yeah. This is a very important person. He went to the school that I teach at, so it's wonderful.
Hi, my name is Rafi. So yes. You know, Kesho. I was interested in... you know, my understanding of American history is quite lacking, as we spoke yesterday. But I know there is a history of resistance within the African American culture, and I'm thinking of Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and most recently, like we spoke about yesterday, Adrienne Rich and bell hooks, and even James Baldwin, that I grew up reading when I was in graduate school. When I was looking at the title of your book, you know, history of survival, habit of survival. You know, I might be reading it wrong, but it almost seems like there is some element of compromise built in there. So I wanted to ask you specifically, how do you balance the idea of the tradition, the history of resistance, which you just spoke about within the African American culture, with your experiences? How do you sort of
absolutely? You know, I'll keep this answer short. Thank you very much. How many times, raise your hand, in a moment of injustice, you felt like you wanted to, and you probably cannot, you wanted to punch someone out, or you wanted to yell and scream, or you wanted to do a number of other things? I think that one of the things that feminist experience has taught me is that I have to have a value system where my actions reflect that my common welfare comes first. So at that moment, I have to judge what is best for me to do. If it is best for me to act in that way where I shut that person down, I will do it and I'm capable of doing it. But there may be moments in which that is not appropriate because I might be the only person of resistance in the room. I know what it's like to be the only woman of faculty of color at a predominantly white institution, tenured in the history of the institution. And if I didn't learn how to be savvy political, carry that balance between the times in which what was best for me and what was best for all of us, then I would in fact only be moving up in that system for myself. And I believe that my education belongs to my community, not just me.
I think that's something really good, because this is what I feel. We've spoken a lot about each one, teach one, but till we don't move out of ourselves and into the community, I think it's going to be very difficult to bring about change.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Whose schooling is it anyway? Whose life is it anyway? Right? Whose resistance is it anyway? Who are you responsive to anyway? Right? And because I grew up in a culture, raise your hand if this was true for you too, where I could be perceived of as sufficient and good if I assimilated into someone else's culture. Then I was perceived of as smart and effective. And that is not what I wanted to do. Anything that was what my mother and my grandparents taught me was not negative. So I had to find that balance between what was positive in my culture and add that on to the American identity, as opposed to not be who I was. Is there any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Hi. You have been talking about the prejudices or struggles that you have to face in the American society as a woman of color, and coming from a certain segment of the society which had to fight discrimination, etc. Generally, in Asia in general and Pakistan in particular, we are told that women have a lot of freedom and liberties in United States, but we also know that there's still a lot of discrimination when it comes to at workplaces and other where in other places between the packages for women and men, and there's still a lot of difference in the treatment they get from the employers. Do you feel that it is a right perception here, or it is more like a media propaganda and it does not really exist?
Well, you know it's video propaganda. I mean, let's be honest, right? Because the perception of, in the American system, is that everybody do what I do. Move your hands up like this. Please, do it. If you move up in the system, you are supposed to gain freedom. Isn't this true? However, I don't bring only my identity as a professional to work. I bring my identity as a woman to work. I bring my identity as a black person to work. Is this not true? And so I might have the credentials, but those credentials are not going to free me from the ignorance and the prejudice of others, right? So I think that, yes, it is absolutely a perception that there's greater freedom. What I do know is that there's greater freedom in resistance, because resistance is collective, that what you then learn, you can share with others. Last comment.
But I would just like to add that whether it's freedom or not, but definitely privilege is there, because if you move up, you do get more privileges, which should not be there, because socially everyone is supposed to be equal. But I have seen it myself, that if I go somewhere, I need something, I'll be addressed first, and then people will serve me. But if there's someone who's not so privileged, and you can always make out, so she will be put aside, and that is why we say our women here, they are doubly oppressed because of their gender, and many of them because of their class. So that is something very important which we must realize. And it's not just freedom, it's also privilege. You may not have the freedom, but you definitely have many privileges. I mean, if you are from the upper class.
So one of the mantras that we say in the United States in the African American feminist movement is that we say, don't whine about your privilege. Tell people what you do with it. Thank you very much. I think we're done.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for attending this very interesting session. Thank you, Zubeda Mustafa.
I'm so glad.
Thank you, Keshu Scott. May I please ask for assistance to help Zubeda come down from the stage? Thank you. Our next session begins at 2:15. We need some time to prepare for it. And my colleague Fahim will introduce the next session.